south of the border, down Mexico way. That's where I fell in love when the stars above came up to play. And now as I wander.
Hello there, all you expat wannabes. I'm Johnny Mueller, and you're listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America, the show that tells you just what it's like to live, work, play, and or retire down here in Latin America. It's a mix of the good, the bad, the ugly, and the great, and it's all right here, so let's get started.
All right, in response to last week's show, when I was talking about what to do and what not to do, when to bribe and when not to bribe, when getting pulled over by the cops here in Latin America, comes this email from Craig. He says, Johnny, doesn't matter if you're black, white, yellow, or green. If you have an attitude when being pulled over by the cops, it will not go down well. Your best move is to always be nice and even over polite, or you will get a ticket or worse. I am a Latino in Nevada, working on my plan B. A Latino born in the U.S., so I'm a U.S. citizen and all that. And yes, I've been pulled over now and again, especially on the highways. And I find that county sheriffs and the state patrol guys, though strict, formal, and even anal, as long as you're polite and nice, they don't mess with you. Though I also noticed if you're a female, even if you're not a hot female, you always have an edge when getting pulled over. That is, as long as the cop, sheriff, or state patrol is a male. I don't know how it turns out when a female cop pulls over a lady. Because the truth of it is that you don't see many female sheriffs or state patrol. But I know for sure, hot chicks, when pulled over, always have an edge. Over the years, my own girlfriend's wife and sisters have told me that. In fact, one of my sisters is a very bad driver, always on the phone or looking in the mirror fixing her lipstick. She has a lead foot, too. She says she must have been pulled over 10 times in the last 5 years, mostly for inattentive driving. Even being forced to take a breathalyzer test 2 or 3 times, and she wasn't even drinking. And out of those 10 times, she only got a ticket once. Because she's a very beautiful and sexy Latina girl. And I'm not just saying that because I'm her brother. That said, Johnny, my plan B is in action. I've got relatives in Nicaragua and El Salvador to lean on. I just might be coming to your January seminar. Oh, and Johnny, when I mentioned to my friends and relatives that I'm moving to Latin America, they all think I'm completely nuts, but then again, they're pretty average and not deep thinkers. They're all working for the man and depend on someone else for their checks. They have no idea that there's even any such thing as an alternative media. In other words, I have little to say to them except, how you doing, how's the wife, the family, and the kids? Oh, and it helps that I know Spanish and I have an IT business, so even though I'm only 38, I won't be panicking anytime soon about the necessity to have a job because I can work anywhere, online. Then he says, though what I really need when I finally make the move is a lawyer to help me set up a few things and a bank account and maybe an SA corporation, etc. So that's about it, Johnny. Keep up the good work. And don't let the people that think you're nuts get you down. I don't. Like you say, Johnny, they're the ones playing musical chairs on the Titanic, not us. We're headed for the lifeboats. So I hope you have a spot left at your seminar for me and the wife. I think and I hope to see you in January. Signed, Craig. P.S. I have one stupid group of fading homemade tattoos on my arm. But don't hold that against me. All right, Craig, thanks for that. And if you do come to the seminar, by all means, bring your sister. Oh, and you know, we always talk about moving your ass and your assets down here to Latin America. And people send me emails all the time saying, Johnny, look, if I pull some dough out of my retirement fund or my 401ks, I'll have to pay taxes and a penalty and all that. You know the rules. And, you know, before this COVID thing, I'd always tell them, look, isn't it infinitely better to take a little hit on your dough right now, pay the taxes and the penalties, etc., knowing that you'll have your dough nice and safe and under complete control of you and no one else? You get your dough out of Dodge, then no court or government agency will ever be able to get their hands on it or lock it up. But still, many gringos and expats are very reluctant to cash out of their retirement plans. The thought of having to pay a penalty, etc., just rubs them the wrong way. Well, you know, you do what you gotta do. But, you know, some good news has come out of this COVID lockdown thing. You know, the so-called CARES Act, you know, the multi-trillion dollar big business and government crony payout that didn't much trickle down to the average guy at all. Well, they slipped one good thing into that act. They let you withdraw up to $100,000 from any retirement plan without getting hit with a penalty. Normally, if you have an IRA or a 401k, if you take them before age 59 and a half, you get a 10% early withdrawal penalty. So sure, there's a lot of bad news out there, but this is very good news, especially if you've got your plan B underway and the ultimate goal is to get some or all of your dough south of the border. So again, under the CARES Act, they allow you to take $100,000 out without penalty. Now, about the tax component, if you pull that money out, if you got a Roth IRA, your withdrawals aren't taxed, but you knew that already, right? But with other retirement and 401 plans, they're all subject to taxes upon distribution. To be clear, that's not a penalty. Those taxes have always applied when you take out the dough. But you see, another good thing is the CARES Act allows for a provision. It's called the Emergency Retirement Plan Withdrawal, so that you pay those taxes over a three-year time period, not all at once. So anyway, that's the story if you've got retirement funds or IRAs and you want to tap into them to get the hell out of Dodge or at least move some of your assets to a Latin American bank. Now, I'm fully aware, when you hear the word Latin American banks, you think, oh no, how are you ever going to know if a Latin bank is stable, that you're not going to wake up someday, get on the net, find out you can't even get to your bank's website, it's out of commission. Hey, those are legit concerns. When I first got down to Latin America and opened up my very first bank account, I think I only deposited $500 in the thing because I wasn't so sure either. Then again, I didn't know anyone who was connected enough to tell me which banks were solid and which ones were in bad shape. Because, you know, for example, one of the first Latin American countries I landed in was Costa Rica, around 1990, and the internet hadn't even kicked in here in Latin America yet. So although some banks had websites, there was no internet banking at all. But every Latin American country had a nice, thick telephone book. Remember those? I bet in the near future they become collectibles. And back in 1990, in Costa Rica, I counted something like 22 banks in the Yellow Pages. So then how did I decide? Well, I didn't throw a dart at the Yellow Pages, though that's what a lot of fresh green gringos and expats did, no lie. I asked my Costa Rican lawyer which one he banked at. And that's the way you got to do it. Now remember, when I first got down here to Latin America, I spoke zero Spanish. So I was completely dependent on what my bilingual Costa Rican lawyer told me and what other gringos and expats told me at those gringo expat bars. And that information, by the way, was next to useless, since I found out over time that every last one of those gringos and expats had been ripped off by someone. Lawyers, real estate guys, other gringos, especially other gringos. A lot of them get-rich-quick schemers. They're everywhere in Costa Rica, even back then, 30 years ago. You can imagine what it's like now. By the way, you long-time listeners probably heard me tell the tale of two lawyers. In Costa Rica, I had two of them, you know. Not because I was any kind of big deal-maker or high roller. It's just that I happened to have hooked up with a very honest lawyer in Costa Rica. What a lucky break that was. A guy who was a professor at one of the law schools, and he was a poet, too. Always a good sign you've found a guy with feelings for others. By the way, I can't stand poetry. It's so dead boring. But poets who have their stuff published, well, that really adds points to a lawyer's resume, don't you think? And this guy had an illustrated book of published poems. And after talking to him for just a few minutes, I knew right away that he was a good-hearted, nice guy who told me up front he wouldn't do anything illegal. Though he knew once in a while you had to bend, even break the law. After all, we're talking about Costa Rica. In other words, pay bribes, etc., to get things done. And he told me up front he wouldn't do that. But he had a lawyer friend who would, so if any shenanigans or bribes were in order, we'd use the recommended other guy. That's why I had two lawyers. And yes, the bad guy came in handy. So what's the point of this little rant? It does have a point, you know. You have to have an honorable lawyer that's on your side, a guy who'll be your friend, a guy that won't lie to you or gouge you. And that's one of the hardest things to find on the tourist trail in Latin America, or even in the States. Of course, the exception is all Latinos will lie to you about being on time. That's to be expected. And no matter what happens or whatever dealings you're having with your Latino lawyer, no matter how uptight you get, he'll say, don't worry. Tranquilo. Calm down. No hay problema. Anyway, and once you find him, he'll be your go-to guy for your bank account and lots of other things. And of course, if the law needs to be bent, broken, or bribes need to be doled out, you want him to be working for you, to be 100% on your side, not the other guys. Oh, and that's another reason it's so nice to be living off the gringo tourist trail. Off the trail, there are so few gringos and expats that local lawyers haven't figured out yet what easy marks we are. However, on the gringo tourist trail, Man, do those Latin lawyers know how to gouge and scam? I'll tell you, they can spot a fresh green gringo just asking to be fleeced as soon as he steps off the plane and walks out of the airport. They've got that look. I can spot them, too. First of all, they've got way too much baggage, and they've got that look that everyone gets the very first time that rush of tropical fresh air hits your face as the airport doors open and you step outside. Oh, and another way to spot a fresh green gringo? Check how much he tips porters and cabbies. Now, of course, Latinos themselves are notoriously rotten tippers, though considered big spenders compared to Germans and Brits. And of course, backpackers of all stamps, they are terrible tippers. And that's why throughout Latin America anyway, almost all restaurants and tiendas, etc., practically any place that's on the books serving food, will have a 10% tip included in the bill. And you won't even know it because it'll say propina. And if you don't speak Spanish, you won't know what that means. So you'll pay it and think it's just, well, part of the bill. That's why I always recommend one of the first Spanish words you learn is propina. Then look at the bottom of your check next time you go to a restaurant and see if that word shows up, and it probably will. If it does, that means it's included, so you don't have to add an additional tip unless you're a nice guy or gal, or you really did get exceptional service. But remember, that 10% propina thing that's customary, that appears right on your bill, that only really came about because Latinos themselves are such terrible tippers. So, in regard to fresh, green, clueless gringos who are down in Latin America for maybe the first or second time, when you see one of these types tipping a guy $5 or $10 at a hotel or a cab or someone taking your bag, you gotta know that guy has not been around. In fact, he's sending signals he's a mark. I know, tipping a bellboy $5, even though it's completely usual and customary in a place like L.A., Chicago, Miami, or New York. Well, let me tell you, if you're off the tourist trail here in Latin America and you do that, for a second, the guy you tipped won't believe it. He'll think you made a mistake. Whether it's a porter or a cab driver, he'll hesitate for a moment, look at the bill and think, no, this can't be right. However, when you're on the gringo tourist trail, Costa Rica, parts of Belize, Mexico, and within 5 or 10 miles of any place that a cruise ship docks to drop off day trippers, well, the fact is the going rate for tips off the gringo tourist trail is 50 cents or a buck. And they're glad to get it because when you're off the gringo tourist trail, it's mostly Latinos who don't tip at all, unless forced to do it. And that's why I've seen this myself while sitting in a restaurant. Sometimes you're sitting there and you see a bunch of backpackers walk up to the front door looking at the menu. Well, I can tell you, I've actually seen waiters and waitresses, called meseras and meseros here, make a face and say to their fellow workers, please, stay outside, don't come in. Why? Because they'll be working their asses off, they always do when it's a big group, and they won't make a centavo more than the 10% tip that's added to the bill. The fact is, I've even seen some Germans and backpackers make a fuss and refuse to pay even the 10%. That always causes a scene and some embarrassment for everyone. But, you know, if the customer presses it hard enough, they will remove that 10%. But believe me, the spectacle it causes, because they have to call the manager. Then they have a little powwow in the kitchen or behind the register, and they come to the table and face a pissed-off customer. Believe me, no matter how bad the service is, and sometimes here in Latin America it's pretty bad, it's best to leave dead dogs lie. Or is it sleeping dogs? Yeah, it's sleeping dogs. And yes, expect to see a few sleeping dogs in restaurants when you're eating out. That's normal down here. Sleeping dogs, not dead ones. That's a good thing. By the way, in all the time I've been down here in Latin America, 30 years now, I've never seen a Latino customer at a restaurant refuse to pay that 10%. Even though they hate to tip, when they see it's included on the bill, they pay. Though I've seen backpackers, Germans, and Brits pull that stunt. So you might ask, have I ever done that? Only once, and it was in Italy. And believe it or not, the waitress actually chased me down the street, waving the check over her head and cursing me in Italian. I'll never do that again. And I'm sure I'll never do it in Latin America because I understand sometimes that 10% that's tagged onto the bill is the only salary some of these waiters and waitresses get. And these days, with the coronavirus, the lockdowns, and the social distancing in restaurants, waiters and waitresses really get shafted. No clients, no tips, no dough. Even though the cost of living and the bills never sleep. Oh, and speaking of the cost of living, I was talking to one of my expat buddies the other day. He lives in Brazil, Sao Paulo, Brazil, population 10 to 15 million, depending how you count it. And I asked him about the cost of living, and he said, oh, it's not bad, about the same as in the U.S. And you know what? I got the same answer from an expat buddy of mine living in Argentina. Not bad, about the same as the U.S. Well, let me tell you, I'd say about 70% of the gringo expat wannabes and gonna-bes listening to this show, they do not want to have their plan B, that is get the hell out of Dodge, only to find themselves in a place where the cost of living is about the same as the place they left. I'd say something's wrong with that equation. Then again, about 30% of the people who listen to this show don't really care that much about money. They're sort of loaded. They've got their plan Bs and want to get the hell out of Dodge because they don't want to be under the thumb of Uncle Sam. They're sick of Big Brother, SJWs, feminism, racism, classism, ageism, and all the other isms. They're sick of being censored, walking on eggshells, and mega taxes. They detest the liars and sociopaths in government. They can't stomach the surveillance state. Turns out people with means and money, they just want out because they detest the sickness that's infecting society up in the States and the fact that they no longer have control over their own lives. Which brings us back to the other 70% of listeners who detest all that as well, but they also have to live on a budget. And they know by the time they hit retirement age, the U.S. will be in such dire straits financially. Unless they get out of Dodge, they'll end up living on hamburger helper, mac and cheese, and cat food. So when I get reports from gringos and expats saying that certain places in Latin America, like Costa Rica, Panama, big cities in Brazil, Argentina, etc., they have a cost of living very similar to that of the States, I just wonder why gringos and expats would ever pick those places. Who are they listening to? Where are they getting their info? International living? Please. And the cure for that disease? Well, come down to my Expat Insider Seminar and see for yourself. We'll set you straight. You'll get the answers you're looking for. And you'll get hooked up with my network, including my longtime friend and seminar lawyer, who's just a guy to not only get you started with your residency. He'll help you with bank accounts, SA corporations, and trusts, if that's what you're interested in, too. So do check out my January 2021 seminar details at expatplanb.com. It's fully explained along with the itinerary, and the early bird discounts are in effect. Check it out at expatplanb.com. All right, then comes this email from Lenny. He says, Johnny, are there any movements in Latin America to demand reparations for indigenous people? Ever since the Spanish conquistadores arrived, they've been cheated out of their gold, out of their land, even out of their religion. The Spanish raped their women and made slaves out of their men, too. It's a fact. You can see it in Spanish newspapers that indigenous people earn less money than their Latino counterparts. They die younger. They go to jail more often. They're more likely to get COVID. Their kids are much more likely to be enrolled in crappy public schools. And since most of them don't have cars, they take crap public transportation chicken buses, too. So, Johnny, you've got the pulse on what's happening down there in Latin America. Are indigenous people, the ones with Inca, Aztecs, and Mayan roots, going to get their reparations anytime soon? Seems like it's definitely in order. Reparations should be coming sooner or later, considering everything that happens up in the first world eventually ends up in Latin America. How about it, Johnny? Then Lenny sent me this link about another particularly oppressed group of people that has never got a fair shake and deserves reparations. Or not. Let me read some of this for you, because it does hit a nerve. It's entitled, When Things Get Ugly. It starts out by saying there's one group of people that has gotten an especially bad deal, an unattractive deal. Ugly people. This article, by the way, comes out of the UK's Daily Mail, where economist Daniel Hammermesh writes that ugliness is no different from race or a disability and suggests unattractive people deserve affirmative action and reparations. He says, quote, my research shows being good-looking helps you earn much more money, find higher-earning spouses, and even better deals on mortgages, he said. Logically, there's no less reason to enact reparations to level out the playing field for the ugly. There's no less reason to protect them than the disabled, African Americans, women, other minorities, and religious minorities, too. What we definitely need to make things right, he says, is affirmative action for the ugly. As he points out, ugly people earn far less money than their more attractive counterparts. Less doors are open to them. They have to work harder to get ahead. The problem is, you see, and the difficulty, how do we decide who is ugly and who's not? And of course, some people are born ugly and get prettier as they age, and just the opposite. Some pretty people grow uglier as they get older, and others don't. Then there's the fact that many men age gracefully, and women usually don't. And it's true, plastic surgery will always improve an ugly person's looks, which then, according to this narrative, would make plastic surgery, along with housing and healthcare, a human right. Naturally, then, this discussion would open the door to many different kinds of reparations. Reparations for short people, bald people, people who stutter, people with bad teeth, cross-eyed people, introverts, extremely hairy people, stupid people with low IQs, people who continuously make bad life decisions, affecting their ability to get a good job or a decent spouse, like, for example, people who eat way too much garlic or have way too many tattoos. According to a certain logic, reparations for many are in order. Then Lenny says, just thought you'd like to know, Johnny, your listeners aren't just sitting back eating bonbons and Cheetos. We're always brainstorming. Lenny, you need your own show, but I think you might be onto something there. And even if you're not, nice try. Thanks for the effort. Oh, and just one thing, Lenny. You wouldn't have a dog in this fight now, would you? You're not short, bald, and ugly, are you? I wonder. Meanwhile, you've heard me mention many times that Mijami seems to be a refuge for scoundrels. Yep, many, many rich, disgraced Latin American politicians and narcos end up in Mijami living happily ever after. How's that happen? So why am I bringing this up? Because another political fugitive just surfaced in Miami. His name is Dalo Bucaram, son of corrupt ex-president Abdallah Bucaram of Ecuador. He and his wife have been spotted living the life of Riley in Mijami. Now, how does that happen? Well, I'll tell you, it's reason 2,647 why it's time to get that plan B moving and get the hell out of Dodge. Unless, of course, you don't mind having fugitive criminals for neighbors. Then again, I've always heard if you've got a scumbag politician or narco kingpin living on the block, you're probably in the safest neighborhood in town. Meanwhile, we've got reason 291. Why it's never a good idea to count on a national healthcare hospital in Latin America for your medical treatment. National healthcare hospitals, meaning your free public hospital system. Turns out news just came out this week that in Ecuador, 291 doctors and specialists have not received their intern and residency pay for more than 8 months. Now I ask you, if you didn't receive your pay for more than 8 months, would you be at your best every day performing with 100% peak efficiency? Or would you be a miserable, complaining killjoy looking for places to hide, taking up space, doing just barely enough to get by? Just saying. When these doctors do get paid, it's from $500 to $1,200 a month. Oh, and one more thing. When I read from these articles or share links with you, if you want a copy or proof for yourself, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com, and I'll send you the articles and the links. I'm bringing this up for you naysayers who might think I'm making this stuff up. Now, why would I do that when there's so much interesting but crazy-ass stuff to talk about? All right, now an email from Tex. He says, Johnny, I've been watching real estate prices in Guatemala as best as I can from here in the States. You've talked about the overbuilding and high vacancy rates for years. I agree with you that the bubble has to burst at some point. Seems to me that the coronavirus and its negative effects on business has to have accelerated the process. Personally, I'm in the market for a house on either Lake Atitlan or in Antigua. Has the bottom dropped out of the real estate market yet? If so, is there anybody you would recommend that could help me? Signed, Tex. Well, Tex, maybe you didn't hear that show I did a couple of weeks ago now, talking all about the real estate bubble and what's happening down here, not just in Guatemala, it's happening all over Latin America. It's pretty much the same thing. They've overbuilt and overbuilt and overbuilt, never thinking they were creating a bubble. They thought it would never end. So here's the situation as I see it, and I've really got my pulse on real estate, believe me. It's a hot topic, and lots of gringos and expats with some cash on hand have been waiting for that bubble to burst. Lots of gringos holding their breath to dive in when the time is right. All right, here's the story. Remember how I've always said you go to olx.com.gt for Guatemala or PA for Panama or whatever other Latin American country you want to check out, whether it's real estate or classified ads? It's their Craigslist. Problem is, for expats and gringos, it's in Spanish. And for that reason, it's a very good way to start learning your Spanish. Just keep checking into those sites every day, and eventually you'll learn enough terms to get you by. So here's what's happening. You know, there's always locals looking to buy a house or real estate. Yet there's more and more properties coming online, especially single-family houses and apartments in residential towers. So in these last few months with people stuck at home, that means Latinos who had the money and were looking to buy, but they were working. Now that they're no longer working, they're sitting at home, checking out real estate and acting on it. That's why, up till now, houses and properties have actually been selling. There's not been a huge drop in sales yet. That is up to now. And you have to remember, all of those residential towers, and in every city, there's dozens and dozens of them in various stages of construction. Obviously, for the past few months, no contractors or laborers have been working on them. That means they're sitting there vacant and unfinished. So, for the last 3 or 4 months, the supply has remained stagnant, and the demand tapering off little by little, as people are short of cash and banks won't lend money to unemployed people. Though now, since no one in Latin America gets any kind of stimulus or relief check and no one's getting bailed out, there are hundreds of properties on the market, and all of a sudden, very few buyers. By the time December and January roll around, there'll be such wailing and moaning and gnashing of teeth in the real estate market, you'll be able to go in there and snap things up at 50 to 75 cents on the dollar. Now, of course, realtors down here are not thinking that way because no one's ever seen anything like this before. In practically every Latin American country except Venezuela and Argentina, who've had previous severe financial blowouts, but elsewhere in Latin America, real estate has always gone up, never down. And like up in the States, about 40% of renters down here are a month or so behind on their rent. Even people who own their apartments and condos are a month or two behind on their maintenance. There's a disaster in the works. Though you can find desperate sellers now, but just wait till December or January. Check OLX.com. Look at the properties that are coming online and what they want for them. Call them up, have a walkthrough, wait a couple days and make a cash offer. Pay attention to properties that have been listed for many months. Take your time. Walk away if you have to. Tell them you're patient, you're not in a hurry. Lowball them. Offer 50 or 75% of what they're asking. Then just sit back and wait it out. They'll come to you. Of course, you'll have to be down here to do the walkthrough and make the offer. And even though some of those properties are offered through brokers like REMAX, realtors have to eat too and they're dying on the vine. So even if you really lowball it, they'll still get their commission. That means definitely they'll push harder than ever to get the owner to take your offer. Normally, I say bypass the broker and go directly to the seller, but sometimes you have to go through the broker. You see that with half the properties on OLX.com. You're kind of stuck with them, but that's all right. With all the desperate sellers that'll be coming online, I predict there'll be lots of realtors who'll panic and jump on any offer, try to shove it down the seller's throat, which is all good for you if you're looking to buy. By the way, Tex, if you're in Guatemala, you can get a hold of Rita, my seminar logistics lady. She knows exactly what to do. Have her set up 4 or 5 walkthroughs, and she'll tag along with you, which is especially helpful if you don't speak Spanish. South of the border. You've been listening to The Expat Files, Living in Latin America. If you need some help with your own Plan B, we can schedule a one-on-one phone or Skype consult. Just send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. And if you want to get on the waiting list for my next week-long Expat Insider Seminar in Central America, where you're guaranteed to get a 2 to 5 year head start on your Plan B, send me an email, theexpatfiles@gmail.com. Nos vemos.